travel all around the world. A lot of them like to bring back souvenirs. That's what we have here. It's a world-class souvenir. It's a giant Tridacna clam shell. Probably the only one in the world like it because it's from Bikini Atoll, a very famous place in 1946 and 1950. That's because the Navy brass got together. They sent a fleet of ships out at Bikini. Then they dropped and set two atomic bombs, a time period between each blast, sunk the whole fleet but one. Then in 1950, they tested the first hydrogen bomb in history at Bikini. Now, I was there in the early 1970s, part of an expedition to shoot 16mm film of the sunken wreck. That's because I had really bright lights to light the wrecks up at the really deep depth they're at. And also, I could do dives with standard scuba gear to 200 plus feet. Now, the end result of this expedition was a 16mm documentary movie put together. Then they came out later on with a DVD here of the movie Deadly Phantoms. I was aggravated by the DVD and the original movie because they edited out a really neat underwater scene or two. Now, there's a book put together about the expedition here called Deadly Phantoms. Now, if we look at this book, we'll see an atomic blast right there, okay? Now we'll look at some pictures of some other atomic blasts with a red arrow pointing to where I found this shell in the early 1970s, but not during the atomic blast. That's just to give you a reference point of where I found it in relationship to the island. I found it alive at that time. Now, this thing did live through all the atomic blasts. So, now, this expedition started by us boarding an airplane, a DC-6, and flying to Madrigal. There's the plane we used. It wasn't Pan American World Airways. We flew to Madrigal, the capital of the Marshall Islands, which Bikini is part of that island chain. There we boarded a ship, the Miko Queen. There's a picture of the ship right there. Now, this was an island freighter. It wasn't very comfortable traveling on this ship. It was kind of an ordeal. First thing, we're down between 6 and 10 degrees off the equator. Hot as hell, no air conditioning on the ship, living on air mattresses on the deck. And then when it would rain, we'd go down to the forecastle, try sleeping in a bunk that's less than 5 feet long. No fun. So this ship takes us to Wochi, Kwajalein, and Bikini. We get to Wochi, and we find out there's a ship there that from the islanders there that was sunk during World War II by Navy planes. So we dive that ship, and we get the bell control jingling, and the steering wheel, and some neat souvenirs off of there, artifacts, a bunch of Japanese plates, potteries, and things like that. And also, anyway, we leave Wochi and we head to Kwajalein and then Bikini. On the way there, there's a person in this book, he refers to him as in a politically correct manner. Well, the fact was this guy was obnoxious as hell, very, very abusive of the Marshallese crew. Someone had to stop this abuse, take a stance. That was me. That helped me get in with the crew and helped me get this shell at the end. So, we get to Bikini, we pull up to the pier with this ship, and we're going to go ashore now. We're thinking about a nice air-conditioned room, shore quarters. No, it's a barracks-type building, like Fort Bragg, 1960. Fort Bragg, you had nice bunks lined up, but here, and pillows. But here, all we had was cots. No mats, just cots, no pillows. But it was, at least they were 6 feet long, or better. Now, the other thing was, the Marshallese people had just moved back to that island. No one had been there for some 20-odd years, or better. And all around that island in the tidal pools was full of lobster. They go out at night with flashlights and reach in and grab these lobster up, bring them in. We have a lobster cookout on the beach. So I'm eating them lobsters and I'm thinking maybe they got radiation in them. Well, I mean, the food was so lousy, you were glad to get some fresh meat. So it turns out, after we left there, they moved the Marshallese off the island because there was high levels of radiation still lingering there on the island, saturating the plants and so forth. So here I am, a lobster and high levels of radiation. So, a typical day at Bikini was to go out there and dive the wrecks, the shipwrecks. We're doing two dives, one in the morning, one in the afternoon, 180, 190 feet, double tanks. We had double tanks. When you see divers with double tanks, you think they're a real diver. But that's because we were on air, and that gave us 20 minutes of bottom time at that depth. So we go out there one day, and we can't dive. We come in early. And we come in early, the ship goes to the pier. There's a huge groundswell crashing into that pier. We can't tie up at the pier, so they go and they anchor out. And let's take a look at right. We can see the island in the relationship where we anchored the ship, but not through any atomic blast. That's just a shot I have of the island. I've been doing all this deep scuba diving and stuff, so I want to get in there and do some free diving, snorkeling around. I jump in the water, swim around that island there in 15, 18 feet of water, and that bottom is a little piece of coral here and there, but nothing to talk about. It just looked like I've been raked over by some bombs, atomic bombs, okay? Then I come up by the ship, and there on this flat rock bottom, no coral, is this giant clamshell sitting there on the bottom. Now, I free dive down around it, and I'm from Florida. It's the first time I've ever seen one of these things, and it's just scared the hell out of me. And there's a surge like this when you're swimming around down there. I'm afraid it would surge me into the clam. Boom! That's it. You've seen the movies where a diver gets stuck in the leg or arm in a giant clam. I didn't want to be in a movie with that happening. So anyway, I come back up, and I tell Marshall Lee's crew member there, I says, man, there's a giant clam. You can be able to see it from here. And scared the hell out of me. Didn't scare him. He puts a mask on, leaps in the water, splash. So then he hollers up to the crew, and they got this big rock like this. They tie ropes on it. They get the cargo crane. They swing it around. They hang that rock on the cargo crane. Well, this thing's sitting on the bottom with the animal in it. It's pushing 450 to 500 pounds. The only way you're going to get it out of the water is with a cargo crane. Unfortunately, for this giant clam, there's a cargo crane handy and a crew of hungry Marshallese. They drop that rock down in it. Boom! That could have been me, curtains. So they bring it up, set it on deck. I go down to check my camera gear and stuff, and the engine room come back up. And in the galley, they got this big scallop, white piece of meat, and they're shaving off pieces. The captain there, the whole crew's in there, they're eating it like mad. Give him some. Okay. So now I'm eating this giant clam, okay? Now, it's been through all these nuclear tests, radiation, everything. Maybe I'm taking some radiation in, maybe the lobster, living in high levels of radiation. Maybe gave me good luck, because the rest of the crew on that expedition, they're all dead. I asked that captain, I said, what are you going to do with the shell? He said, I'm going to throw it over. I said, any possibility I could have it? He goes, you've been standing up with my crew, you got it. So they tied up with ropes and everything nice for me and everything. This shell's sitting on the bottom there. Let's talk about it. They set that first atom bomb off. It stands a battleship on end. In comes a wall of water, radiation, fallout and everything. The second atom bomb, fallout and everything. It's still sitting there. That's your best shot? That's all you got? It's a couple of atom bombs? I'm still here. They said, no, Clam, that ain't our best shot. Now we're going to test the first hydrogen bomb in history, okay? That hydrogen bomb was supposed to be a little stronger than an atom bomb. Turns out to be 5, 10, 15 times stronger. Don't quote me, look it up. There's an island there, a 5-acre island. There's just a 200-foot hole in the ocean there now. That's it. And so all that comes in here crashing over. It's still here. It's still there, okay? It made it through all that. Now these shells, these giant Tridacna clams, they can live for a life expectancy of over 100 years. It takes a long time for them to get this big, so it was definitely there during all of the atomic blast. But that just say when they set that first atom bomb off, it's only half this size. Then in some 20 odd years, it grew this big from all that radiation and fallout and everything. I mean, you've seen the movie Godzilla. It happened to Godzilla. It could have happened here, okay? We don't know. Okay. So we're supposed to dive that hydrogen bomb hole, but the weather came up, and they flew the plane in for Madrol to get us. And it flies in, circles the islands a couple times, and lands. Hey, why are you guys circling the island so much? Oh, that's a short runway. That's a really short runway. You know, 1 foot on each side of the runway in the ocean. So we load this stuff on the plane. This thing's pushing 300 pounds. The stuff from Wochi is about another 125 pounds or something like that. We get on that plane, and we get ready to take off. Now, it taxis down the runway, and it spins the back end around. I'm sitting in the seat there behind the wing, and I can look down and see the ocean. They wanted to give every inch of one runway they could get. So I look up and see the pilot and co-pilot and the space between them. You know, I can watch this takeoff. So I creep up there, no one says anything. When I get there, it gets lower. I go down on my knees, and I grab a stanchion on each side of their two chairs, the co-pilot and pilot. I'm hanging on to it because I got no seatbelt. I got to think head safety. So that plane starts heading down the runway. And I'm watching that runway, the ocean coming at us where it ends. And all of a sudden, that captain of the plane goes, this plane's heavy. This plane's heavy. What the hell they got back there? And that's when it dawned on me. I go, what the hell they got back there? I got a giant clamshell, man. Now all of a sudden, it's going around and around, short runway, extra weight and everything. And all I'm really hanging on tight. So I watch that runway end, and I can see the waves. The plane leaves. The waves are staying the same height. We're staying the same height. We're not getting any higher. Them wheels are touching water, I guarantee you. And all. So I'm tensing up. I'm getting ready for the crash, man. I'm almost ripped them stanchions off their chairs. I'm so, pulling so hard. And watching those waves, and finally that plane lifts up. Them pilots, they had some choice words to make, man. But I just heard a little part of it, and I turned around and went back to my seat. My conscience was clear. Now this book here, they should rename the book. It shouldn't be Deadly Fathoms. Deadly Giant Clamshell almost crashed his plane. That was the most dangerous part of the expedition, I know. Okay. So we land in Madrigal, and on comes the Marshallese, Commissioner of the Marshall Islands, some chieftains. They're in the back of the plane of Oregon. I go back right here. Wochee's part of our territory. We're seizing this, and even the Marshallese government, all that stuff's leaving. Okay, it's gone. Then he comes walking by my shell here, and he stops, and he looks at it, and I figure that's it. Now he's going to seize it. And he goes, did they eat that? And I said, oh yeah, the crew and the Miko Queen, they caught it, and they ate it. He goes, oh, I wish I was there. I love eating those things. And I go, well, I ate some. Might be radioactive. That's healthy food. So he leaves. Man, that was close. I thought, bye-bye, shell. Now, what they didn't know is I had some 4 sake glasses and a sake container hidden in my diving gear. So I got those souvenirs I brought back with me. So I got that. So anyway, I got back. I didn't realize how rare this shell was, how unique it was. I let my father-in-law have it for his fish pond. It got some dents in it from them cleaning the pond and stuff. He passed on. The property got sold last week. Before it changed hands, I went down and got my shell back. So now this is part of my shell collection. I've been collecting shells for about 16 years, and I got some really rare shells. Now, if you're a shell collector and I tell you I've got a cone shell that's 170 millimeters, you know I got a rare shell. Caught it off Hawaii. Now, this is the rarest shell in my collection and the largest. So if you found that interesting, subscribe.